Dit is Papa Alpha 0 Echo Tango Echo. Optimisme is een verantwoordelijkheid als er een natuurramp gebeurt. Vertrouw jij dan je leven toe aan het feit dat mobiele telefoons en internetverbindingen nog werken? Vertrouw je daar het leven van je gezinsleden aan toe? Ik dacht het niet. Amateurradio. Communicatie die altijd blijft werken. Goedenavond, dit is de lange uitzending van de Daily Minutes, ook bekend als PNL Nieuws. In deze wekelijkse uitzending beginnen we met Amateur Radio Newsline, met de datum van deze vrijdag, met wereldwijd nieuws over onze hobby in het Engels. Aan het eind van de uitzending zenden we de Deutschlandrundspruch uit, het landelijk nieuws van die week, van de Duitse amateurvereniging DARC. Deze bijdrage is in het Duits.
Amateur Radio Newsline Report number 2139 with a release date of Friday, October 26, 2018 to follow in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The following is a QST. A noted DXer is detained in the Republic of Chad. Hams help Florida rebound from Hurricane Michael, and Halloween QSOs are yours for the taking in Transylvania, Louisiana. All this and more as Amateur Radio Newsline Report 2139 comes your way right now.
From around the world, this is Newsline, Amateur Radio's first independent, on-the-air news and bulletin service. Now, reporting from Wadsworth, Ohio, Stephen Kinford, N8WB.
This is Don Wilbanks, AE5DW, with breaking news. Our top story this week takes us to the Republic of Chad, where Ken Opskar, LA7GIA, has been released following his detention while on de-expedition there. He received word from authorities as Newsline went to production this week. His de-expedition is over, but he's headed home to Norway. Correspondent Ed Durant, DD5LP, tells what happened.
Ken was barely one day into his operation as a single operator, TT8KO, from the 31st Most Wanted DX entity, when local police ordered him to cease operations on October 10th, pending an equipment inspection by the head of police himself. His detention in Chad went well past his scheduled end of operations on October 21st. He told Amateur Radio Newsline in an email on October 23rd that the Norwegian embassy had stepped in to talk to local officials. Meanwhile, he was safe and comfortable in his hotel, posting updates on the DX World website to reassure the amateur community that their emailed wishes were bringing him good cheer. By his earlier account, police had found all of his documents to be in order, but his detention continued. Ken's earlier post on the website said he believed the Chad's telecommunication regulator, ARCEP, had failed to inform local police of his plan to operate a de-expedition. As such, his gear has been disconnected and he had no further access to his radios or antennas. According to his online log, Ken had made 2,135 QSOs in CW during his one day on the air. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Ed Durant, DD5LP.
In the U.S., as the Florida Panhandle continues to piece lives and communications back together after Hurricane Michael slammed into the northern part of the state, hams assisting the northern Florida section of Ares have returned home after 2 weeks in the field, working five-day rotations. Section Emergency Coordinator Carl Martin, KG4HBN, told Amateur Radio Newsline that the Florida Department of Emergency Management covered communications from shelters to county and state emergency operations centers. The hams relied mostly on HF, using 80 meters and 40 meters, relying on SARnet, the statewide amateur radio network of UHF-linked voice repeaters, as backup for handling traffic and other communications. Carl said that for 2 weeks, there were more than 50 operators either deployed or handling traffic and serving as net control at stations outside the affected areas. Efforts focused on the counties of Bay, Gulf, Calhoun, Jackson, Library, and Gadsden, all of which were heavily hit. He told Newsline, quote, "Times like this make me proud to be an amateur radio operator when people from all over come to lend their skills, equipment, and lives to help others in need," end quote. As restorations continue in this devastated part of the American South, Newsline will provide updates. In the meantime, Mississippi Senator Roger Wicker went on social media to formally recognize all hams' contributions in the disaster response effort. A personal call sign for one ham in the UK has turned out to be a possible first for the regulator issuing it. Here's Jeremy Boot, G4NJH.
For John Gascoigne, M5ET, an amateur radio operator in the UK, almost everything about ham radio has held special significance. He received his foundation license with the call sign M6XLX on the 12th of December 2012, or 12-12-12, and enjoys taking note of the distinctive date. After a number of license upgrades, John received his most recent call sign on the 12th again, in this case the 12th of October, just earlier this month. M5ET is a personalised call sign which has significance for Ofcom as well as for him. It's believed to be the first M5 plus 2 letter call sign issued by the UK communications regulator, and John chose it for personal reasons, he told Newsline. John works hard to make sure that others find radio significant too. He's been active in helping to create the GB2GP permanent special event station at Gilwell Park, the UK headquarters for the Scout Association. The station holds five major events, giving between 10 and 20,000 youngsters a chance to spend time in the shack. John also helps organise a casual contest team there. Last year, GB2GP was host to YOTA 2017, a week-long gathering of 80 youngsters representing 26 different countries. He also manages a UK-wide national unit to encourage more adult leaders to scouting, especially those with an interest in amateur radio. Outside of scouting, he belongs to the UK ground team of ARIS, RayNet UK and the Cam Hams Amateur Radio Group. In his spare time, he's keen on AMSAT, HFSSB and HF data operations and the occasional contest. So if you hear M5ET calling QRZ, that'll be John with his new distinctive call sign. Answer his call, no doubt you'll find plenty to talk about. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Jeremy Boot, G4NJH.
Speaking of call signs, a few more hams were assigned theirs this month in South Africa after great success at their radio amateur exams. Here's Jim Meachin, ZL2BHF, with more on that story.
Congratulations to the newest amateur radio license holders in South Africa. The results of the OCT-13 radio amateurs exam were released on Friday, the 19th of October. And from Port Elizabeth to Pretoria, the candidates did well. 75 people passed the Class A exam, earning the right to a ZS or ZR prefix. Class A is equivalent to the full license in the UK and allows an operating power of up to 1 kilowatt. Four candidates passed the Class B exam, which permits 100 watts of operation and is equivalent to the UK Foundation license. The new Class B license holders, who must be younger than 20, will be assigned call signs with a ZU prefix. They will be permitted to keep that license until their 25th birthday. South Africa's licensing exams are only given twice a year. The next tests will not be given until May. We welcome the nation's newest hams to the bands. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Jim Meachin, ZL2BHF.
Time for you to identify your station. We are the Amateur Radio Newsline, heard on bulletin stations around the world, including the W7GAA repeater in Bullhead City, Arizona, on Friday nights at 7:30 local time. More than a dozen YLs spent a recent weekend on a dry dock submarine in Oklahoma calling QRZ. It was a first for some of them, but it won't be the last, as Jim Dameron, N8TMW, tells us.
There's nothing like calling QRZ from a dry docked submarine in Oklahoma to make for a successful weekend. A group of 14 YLs from Kansas, Texas, and Oklahoma climbed aboard the USS Batfish in Muskogee, where they operated on the HF bands for 3 days, beginning October 12th, and even slept on board as guests of the USS Batfish Radio Club, WW2SUB. With the help of the club's host, Wade Harris, KF5IF, they hung antennas and made use of the club's portable tower and one of its three radio systems, and even set up satellite systems. According to a post on the South Canadian Amateur Radio website, the submarine experience marked the first time some of the YLs got on the HF band. By the end of the weekend, the team had logged 350 contacts while honoring two lost subs, the USS Wahoo and the USS Dorado. One highlight of the YL's experience, however, was something perhaps a bit more terrestrial. Virginia, NV5F, played her bagpipes for the team. According to Mark Klein, N5HZR, the YLs are ready to take another dive on the submarine next October, but meanwhile are looking for a similar site for a weekend operation in Dallas, Texas. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Jim Dameron, N8TMW.
Are you preparing for the ARRL's Ritty Roundup in January? Kevin Trotman, N5PRE, tells us why FT8 enthusiasts are excited too.
If you're looking forward to the 2019 ARRL Ritty Roundup, and you're also a fan of FT8, you'll be glad to know that the new FT8 protocol is being permitted in the contest to be held in January. FT8 had been excluded from this year's contest because it was unable to manage the required exchanges, according to the ARRL. The latest version of the software, which is part of the WSJTX software suite, has fixed that. So, if you're hoping to get in on the action, just be sure you're running version 2.0 or later so that you can transmit and receive the mandatory exchanges. The Ritty Roundup, which is scheduled for January 5th and 6th, is considered by the ARRL to be a good opportunity for beginners to get started in digital mode contesting, which the Ritty Roundup has permitted for 3 decades. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Kevin Trotman, N5PRE.
In the UK, one soda activator has scaled to new heights in the International Awards Scheme. Here's Jeremy Boot, G4NGH, with those details.
Worthwhile achievements take time, and David Stansfield, G0EVV, would probably agree. The amateur, who is from Morpeth in northern England, is an activator in the Summits on the Air Awards Scheme. After 6 years of activations, mostly in Scotland and northern England, he's achieved the coveted status of Mountain Goat, the title activators receive after reaching 1,000 points. It's been a long and intense journey for David since his first SOTA activation, Place Fell, G/LD027, in the Lake District in May of 2012. He achieved the pinnacle of Mountain Goat on September the 11th this year, when he activated Ben McDewey, GM/ES001, in the Cairngorms. According to his profile on QRZ, David is from an amateur radio family. His son and daughter are both licensed, as was indeed his father, who is now a silent key. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Jeremy Boot, G4NJH.
NASA will be transmitting commemorative images on Slow Scan TV, and you can tune in. Neil Rapp, WB9VPG, has more.
Now here's a TV transmission you can't set your video recorder or DVR to capture. It's a slow scan TV event aboard the International Space Station. With the support of NASA's Space Communication and Navigation Department and enabled by ARIS and Russian international partners. And hams have been invited to participate. The ARIS transmission is to begin at about 10 a.m. UTC on October 27th, and it will be a downlink of 12 images. The transmissions are being broadcast on 145.800 megahertz using the PD120 SSTV mode. 6 images will feature the educational activities of the Space Communication and Navigation Department, and the other 6 will commemorate such anniversaries as the first manned lunar landing in 1968 and the establishment of NASA itself in 1958. Images can be posted and viewed afterward at an ARIS website. See our website, arnewsline.org, for a printed script of this newscast, which contains an online link to that website. NASA has been celebrating a number of its anniversary moments all year long, and this event is part of that celebration. Amateur radio clubs at various NASA centers often operate special event stations, marking these milestones, and hams are able to receive certificates for successful contacts. In making its announcement about the Slow Scan TV event, ARIS cautioned that the event was subject to change and dependent on schedules and ISS crew responsibilities. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Neil Rapp, WB9VPG.
In this week's World of DX, listen for Peter, DC0KK, operating as 4S7KKG in Sri Lanka, starting November 1st through April 1st. He prefers operating CW and on the digital mode. Send QSLs via his home call sign, direct and by the Bureau. Logs of all QSOs will be uploaded to Logbook of the World and Club Log. Eric VA2IDX will be active from Anticosti Island as VA2IDX/P from November 2nd to the 7th. Be listening on 40 and 20 meters. He will be operating QRP on SSB and possibly CW. QSL via his home call sign, direct and by the Bureau. Meanwhile, if you can't wait for summer in the Southern Hemisphere, it's likely you also can't wait for the Bouvet Island de-expedition of 3Y01. While the Revel DX group has yet to announce the exact days of the activation on the world's most remote island, they have identified which bands and modes they'll be using for SSB, CW, and FT8. For details, visit their website, bouvettoya.org. Finally, with Halloween nearby, Newsline asks, do you stand a ghost of a chance for some good context on HF? Mike Askins, KE3-CXP, has the answer.
What's scarier than an encounter with the Walking Dead? An encounter with the HF bands in the same condition. Short of hosting an exorcism, your best option might just be to hit push to talk anyway and join some hams in Louisiana who are hosting a BOO-SO party. Yes, that's BOO-SO. A ham radio activity designed to scare up some contacts. The Louisiana Delta Radio Club, KC5DR, will be at one of the region's most visible haunts, the Transylvania Louisiana Water Tower, calling QR Dead, that is QRZ, on the 27th of October from 1600 UTC to 2200 UTC. There's no requirement to show up in costume, but the town's water tower itself is dressed for the occasion year-round. It bears the likeness of a giant flying bat with its wings spread, joining everyone on the air. So be listening for KC5DR on HF, and if you think you're hearing voices, you'll know for sure that band conditions aren't a complete horror show. The hams will be logging all contacts, and as Dracula himself might say, keeping count. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Mike Askins, KE5-CXP.
With thanks to Allen Labs, Amateur News Weekly, the ARRL, CQ Magazine, DXWorld.net, EURAO Newsletter, Kenneth Opskar, LA7GIA, Lloyd Calston, KC5-FM, Hap Holly, and The Rain Report, Irish Radio Transmitter Society, Joe Holland, KB5-VJY, Carl Martin, KG4-HBN, Ohio Penn DX Bulletin, Sonoma County Radio Amateurs Club, Southgate Amateur Radio News, Ted Randall's QSO Radio Show, Variety Wireless Institute of Australia, WTWW Shortwave, and you, our listeners. That's all from the Amateur Radio Newsline. Please send emails to our address at newsline@arnewsline.org. More information is available at Amateur Radio Newsline's only official website at www.arnewsline.org. For now, with Karen Eve Murray, KD2GUT, at the news desk in New York, and our news team worldwide, I'm Stephen Kinford, NAWB in Wadsworth, Ohio, saying 73, and as always, we thank you for listening. Amateur Radio Newsline is copyright.
This is The Doctor Is In, your bi-weekly podcast that discusses all things technical and not so technical. The Doctor Is In podcast is produced by ARRL, the National Association for Amateur Radio, and sponsored by DX Engineering, helping you shrink the globe. See their website at www.dxengineering.com. And now, here's your host, QST Editor Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and the doctor himself, Joel Hallis, W1ZR.
Hello, I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY.
And I'm Joel Hallis, W1ZR.
Joel, I don't know if you have a chance to listen to our music yet. We have new music.
Oh, no, I hadn't heard it yet.
You could dance to it. It's got a...
That's going out quite a ways. I can't dance to much of anything.
Well, be that as it may, let's talk about towers, because I wanted to start this by saying that my spouse and I have an agreement. She lets me put wires pretty much wherever I want in the trees that are on our small property. But she draws the line at a tower. Many years ago, she said, no. You know, you can put your wires up, but no towers. And I've come to grips with that reality, but boy, I wish I had a tower. Am I missing out on a lot?
Well, it depends on how many trees you have and how high they are. It's one thing. Towers are a definite plus. There's no question about it. They set the stage for efficient antennas that can be well-defined and constructed, and you can also often put them sort of in the clear, whereas if you put wires in trees, they're usually in the trees.
Yes.
So we found recently from some work reported in a recent QST article that I don't have in front of me that trees are not always your friend about propagation through them and things like that.
That's true.
So,
yes.
You know, but a tower can help with that. Still, I would guess that the majority of hams don't have a tower.
That's true. In fact, we ran a survey last year and discovered that only 30% of amateurs have towers.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me at all because there are a lot of commitments about that. Not only financial, but there's also spousal issues and neighborhood issues and town zoning issues and all kinds of things that come up when you move into the realm of towers. So a tower isn't necessary, but what is necessary is for an amateur station to have one or more antennas, and they need to be supported by something. So that's the real key here, is if you don't have anything else to support them by, towers may be all that's left, although there are a lot of ground-mounted antennas that can be supported on the ground, for example. Many people are happy with verticals or even arrays of verticals that are just stuck in the ground or perhaps guide and are perhaps less offensive to the neighbors than a tower and usually stick up less high than a tower. Many people associate towers with beams, which is often the case, but not always.
I tend to do that.
Because that really gives you a support that allows a beam to be properly mounted and allows it to turn without running into branches and all kinds of things. But people have successfully used VHF and small HF antennas on TV mounts on chimneys and on the ends of their house without a tower. And in fact, I have a similar thing. Actually, my arrangement looks like it's mounted on a TV chimney mount because it's actually a mast that's a couple inches from the chimney, but it's not attached to the chimney at all. In fact, it's well attached to the house. It's about 33 feet off the ground, and it holds up an HF tribander with a 6-meter coupled resonator antenna, three element, and a 4-element, 2-meter Yagi. So I have, 20, 15, 10, 6, and 2 on a rotatable system that is not on a tower and looks fairly inoffensive, especially when the leaves are on the trees and it's not that visible. And nobody's ever called me on it, even though I'm not even sure it's quite within my zoning rules. But usually what happens is nobody does anything about that unless someone complains.
Yes.
So far, it's been up there for a long time, and nobody's complained, and I've been relatively happy with it. Now, it would work better at 50 feet than at 33 feet, no question about it, but, I'm up to, at the moment, 289 confirmed countries and stuff, so, it is getting out, and I use wire antennas on the other bands, and good combination of that. So, well, I do have a lot of trees, and I have tall trees, so that makes it relatively easy to do wire antennas as well.
For those who do want to put up a tower, they decide that, unlike you, the roof isn't a good option and so on. They do want to put up a tower. Is there any sort of optimum height to consider? For example, over here at W1AW, our towers are about 100 feet in height. Is a 100-footer necessary? Is a 30-foot adequate? How do you decide?
Well, I guess the big question there is not the number of feet, it's the fraction of a wavelength. And of course, most Yagi antennas are on multiple bands, so they have different...
Yes.
If they're all just, they can only be at one height. And that's kind of the issue here, because there have been a number of articles in QST about the optimum height for a Yagi. The general consensus is that for a 20 through 10 meter multi-band Yagi, horizontal Yagi, for DX operation, a height of 50 to 105 feet is about optimum. Now, 50 is probably more optimum for 10 meters and 105 more for 20. And what happens is, as the antenna gets higher, the lowest lobe in the vertical plane goes down to a lower elevation angle, which gives you a longer path to the F-flare where you want to refract from. So as you go up, that lobe comes down. That's the good news. The bad news is, as you go up at about a half to three-quarters of a wavelength, you have primarily one fairly wide lobe. At half a wavelength, it's at about 30 degrees elevation, but it probably has a beam width of perhaps 20 degrees. So from, let's say I'm making this up, but from 20 degrees to 40 degrees, you're putting out a good signal, which covers a lot of distances to a refraction point. Now, as you go up higher, instead of being at 30 degrees, the peak will drop down and down and down and down. Let's say you get it down, you go up towards 100 feet, and I'm just guessing it's down to 10 degrees on 20 meters. The beam width of that lobe is significantly less. It's a very narrow beam, And then you will also have a null, a deep null, at angles like, perhaps 15 or 18 degrees. So some of the angles that you want disappear completely with that higher antenna, which is why going higher is always better for the lowest angle of lobe, but it's not best for the general conditions. You know, for that one station exactly halfway around the Earth, if you can get it on one hop instead of two, that's great. But that may mean that's the only station you can talk to.
Yes.
It's not quite that bad, but that's something of an issue there. So the optimum is not necessarily the highest. Now, what some people do to get around that is they have beams at multiple heights. If you look at a contest station, that you'll find they may have two or three Yagis on 20 meters, one up at the 100-foot level and one at 50 feet. They can do a lot of things with that. They can select one or the other, which makes sense for some cases. If they feed them in phase, they'll actually have a perhaps almost 3 dB additional gain, as if the antenna were halfway in between at 75 feet, which is a good height for many distances. And in some cases, they actually put them out of phase, and that pushes the elevation angle way up. So it tends to be almost NVIS type thing, but it's very good for intermediate range stations. So you can do a lot with multiple heights. Some people do that by actually raising and lowering the antenna, which is also possible. There are a couple of motorized arrangements that can do that. But now you're talking significantly more money and complicated systems that can break in the night and stuff.
Well, speaking of complicated systems and money, I have a few questions for you, but before I do, let's take a break for DX Engineering, and we will return.
Our fellow hams have told us how much they love receiving the DX Engineering catalog. It's 132 pages of amateur radio heaven, packed with competitively priced equipment. You'll find everything from multiband Yagis to whip antennas, the latest base transceivers to mobile radios, and every accessory under the sun. But the catalog only represents a small part of what DX Engineering offers. When you visit dxengineering.com, you'll find thousands of items from trusted names like ICOM, Yaesu, Kenwood, and Elinco. There's world-famous antennas from OptiBeam, E-Antennas, and M-Squared, Rhone and American Towers, plus many more. And shop a wide selection of innovative DX Engineering brand products. They're designed and manufactured by our team of amateur radio enthusiasts for hams just like you. Plus, you get the fastest shipping in the ham universe, and shipping is free on most orders over $99. Experience ham radio heaven at dxengineering.com. That's dxengineering.com.
And we're back. And we were talking during the break that we should, we've been focusing on HF, but we should talk about VHF and UHF in regards to towers as well.
Absolutely, because in many cases, that's where people started doing them, because a lot of VHF operation is line of sight. And in general, the higher you are, given particularly flat terrain, for example, which we don't get too much of around here, but some people do, the higher you go in antenna height, the longer the range you have before you run into the radio horizon and your signal disappears. Now, that's not quite as big a thing in some kinds of propagation, such as meteor scatter, which doesn't need to go that low an angle, or troposcatter, or those kinds of things. But in general, the higher you are on VHF, the better, for two reasons. One, you get longer line of sight. The other is, while there's some attenuation of HF signals going through trees, there's lots of attenuation of VHF and higher frequency signals going through trees or anything else. The serious VHF operators try to get their antennas above the tree line. When I lived in Massachusetts, they have a lot of trees up there, as they do here. I used to somewhat chuckle at some of my friends who had their 100-and-some-odd-foot towers with their VHF Yagis on top, and every year they'd have to, every couple of years, put another 10 feet on because the trees kept growing, and they'd have to keep pace with the trees. So some of them got pretty tall. That can be an issue for VHF operators. Also, another advantage of the tower compared to other things you might do is the tower not only can hold up antennas, but it's a structure that can hold up other things. The serious VHF operator, especially with a big tower, is much better off if they can have their preamp and power amplifiers near the antenna at the top of the tower. It's pretty easy to clamp them onto a tower and run the power up to them and so forth. Much harder if you're dealing with trees. So it's a structure that can hold up more than just antennas. It can hold up auxiliary equipment of that sort. And what you do then is you don't no longer have the 2 or 3 dB of transmission line loss in the coax going from the top of the tower down to your station. You still have that, but it's on the side of the amplifiers that you can control. So you need to turn up your exciter to drive the amplifier a little harder, and you come up with, you know, your full legal limit at the antenna, not at the station. And that makes a big difference in your range and so forth.
If my spouse has a sudden change of heart and allows me to put up a tower, which is when you know what freezes over.
Yeah.
But anyway, just for the sake of discussion, am I going to have to get a building permit for this?
It depends on your local zoning and building code rules. You may not only have to get a building permit, you may first have to get a zoning exception. Almost every town around here anyway, and I'm not sure if this is the case everywhere, probably not, has rules about how high a structure can be in different kinds of zones. In our town, we have A, B, and C or something, or AA and AAA residential lot sizes, and they all define how big the lot can be, how close you can be to the property edge, and how tall your structure can be. And in most rules that I've looked at, and you really need to look at yours. This is not a generalization. Every town has their own rules. But for example, they'll say no structure can be more than X number of feet above the top of the house. So if your house can be, let's say, round numbers 30 feet high, you may be restricted to a 40-foot tower by those rules. So what that means is you may need to go and get an exception or apply for an exception and hope you get an exception that allows you to go higher. There are other rules you have to worry about too. Some towns have rules about towers. They don't necessarily say how high they can be, but they say if they fall over, they have to land in your property.
Oh, of course.
Which is fairly reasonable. Now, if you have a 25 by 25 foot lot and you put a tower in the center, that means you can go 12 feet high. And that's about it. So it gets kind of tough. So there are all kinds of aspects of this. Now, perhaps you're in some place where nobody has rules. I'm sure there are places like that. I've never lived in one for some reason. But there seem to be places where people can put up just about anything they want, and that gets around all of this. Some places require a certified professional engineer to do the design work and must submit plans signed off and sealed by the engineer to show that it's likely to stand up. And, you know, all of that's money. That stuff can easily outstrip the costs of the tower itself.
I'm sure, yes. And when the time comes to finally install the tower, I know a lot of people that will do it themselves. They will dig the hole and mix the concrete and all that. But what is your recommendation? What does the doctor recommend? Should you get somebody else who truly knows what they're doing to do it? Or is this a DIY, a do-it-yourself?
Well, I've participated in do-it-yourself tower installations, and as far as I know, they're still up. That was some years ago. But even the professional ones come down from time to time. So I think it's worth considering having somebody install it, or at least consult with you on the installation. Perhaps the engineer that you have to get can lead you through the steps, and you can say, well, I could do those steps, but maybe I'll have the engineer or tower constructor come out and look at my installation of reinforcing bar in the base and so forth. And I guess some kinds of towers may be more critical than others in that regard. For example, a self-supporting tower that's just relying on the concrete base, which is usually a pretty big base for a decent-sized tower, requires very careful design to make it hold the antenna up. Where a guide tower, you have to have some consideration to the forces on the guy wires, but I think in general, they're a little less critical. I may be overgeneralizing here. When we were in school, people used to say, well, an engineer is someone who can do for a dollar what any idiot can do for five. So the other thing is, if you try to do it yourself, the chances are you'll overbuild.
Yes.
And end up spending more money maybe on how much concrete you think you might need than you would if you got somebody who could tell you with this kind of soil and these characteristics and this wind load and that and the other thing. You know exactly what you need, and you can do that, or you can have them do it, or have somebody else do it. So I think it's important to have good data to work with and a good understanding of what the actual forces are and the requirements are on what's going to hold the tower up.
Well, I'm going to put you on the spot then. Just your opinion. I understand that. We know that towers, typical tower, 30, 50 foot, could cost, when you're all done, a couple of $1,000.
Easily, yeah.
Easily. Is it worth it?
A tower, it would be worth it to me, let me tell you that. I mean, what do you pay for the other things? Let's see, the beam on the tower will have, of course, you got to buy the beam, is another $1,000 or something too, at least, depending on what you get. Now, what are your alternatives? Well, instead of the beam, if you have a reasonably high dipole or four or five of them in different directions on different bands, the beam will give you perhaps 6 or 8 decibels improved signal strength in some directions. Now, if it's going where the dipole is pointing, it'll probably be closer to 6, but if it's going towards the ends of a dipole or in the gaps between the coverage of them, it could be 8 or even 10 dB. What other options do you have? Well, 6 dB is 4 times the power. So if you go from 100 watts to 400 watts, you get the same gain in signal strength, perhaps, with a linear amplifier. Mm-hmm. And it probably will cost you less. If you need 10 dB, now you're talking 1,000 watts, you're kind of up an increment on amplifier size. So, you know, that's one way to look at it. On the other hand, the guy you're competing with in the pileup has probably got both. So he's got the amplifier and the tower
and the tower.
So, so if you want to compete with that ham for the same pileup contact or not be the last one to get one, you know, you need to have both. So you have to kind of weigh these things and perhaps, you know, maybe I guess I would argue that the amplifier is easier to install than the tower for sure.
Certainly.
And you may want to go there first. On the other hand, the Yagi with a rotator provides additional rejection of unwanted signals and has other advantages. So, you know, it's a trade-off like everything else. To me, that would be my next step. I have a medium-sized amplifier, and I have this antenna at about 33 feet, and I think to go to a tower would cost me more because I would have to move to a different town that would allow me to have a higher structure. So it would cost a lot more than a couple thousand dollars.
And I'd have to have a different spouse.
Yeah, that's not cheap either.
Well, Joel, do you have time for a question?
I think
as long as we're at it here.
Sure, why not?
Okay. But before we get to the questions, you had some comments about mineral oil, I believe.
I have a couple of comments, yeah. Actually, I get it's kind of interesting because it actually indicates to me some people are actually listening to this stuff when they send me comments. You know, often suggestions about things that I could add to something I've said. So I've got a couple of them this time. The first one, indeed, is about mineral oil. We talked about that as something that's used in some kinds of dummy loads. And I noted that you had to watch out for transformer oil that may contain PVCs, which can be, is that what I mean? No, PCBs, sorry.
PCBs.
PCBs, which can be harmful to your health. And that mineral oil from the drugstore is a substitute, which I've used. John, KB7BTO, mentioned that if instead of going to the pharmacy, you go to an agricultural feed store, that mineral oil is available by the gallon for about the cost of a pint at the pharmacy. So,
wow.
Well, what you get at the pharmacy is something you can put inside you. What you get at the feed store is something you can put inside a horse. Now, the horse may think he needs very good mineral oil, but he doesn't get a vote on that, I guess. So if you're getting it by the gallon at the agricultural store, I think it will probably handle the power just as well as what the pharmacy has.
I'll see why not.
Yeah. Then a couple others here. On August 2nd, speaking of towers and rotators, I mentioned the desirability of having a thrust bearing above the rotator between the mast and the top of the tower to limit the side forces trying to snap off the rotator. Physicist Chris Smith, NX0E, wrote to let me know that a thrust bearing is actually a bearing designed to support the downward forces on the rotator in line with the mast. And he says the function I was talking about would be better described as a sleeve bearing to resist sideways forces. Although, in fact, the thrust bearing can help with both kinds of forces, and it also has the additional advantage that it can hold up the antenna and mast so you can actually change out the rotator without having to take the antenna off. So it's a good thing to have for many reasons, no matter what you call it. And then finally, on the September 13th podcast about tools for every ham, I mentioned that in addition to the Phillips screwdrivers that we're used to, there are some made in offshore that are not to the Phillips patent.
Right.
In fact, some of them are very specific designs that are built to the Japanese industrial standard. This is a note from Craig, WE2DX. And he notes that they generally mark JIS on the shaft with a size number also. And Craig has found them necessary to work on not only Asian manufactured radios, but also Chinese and Japanese bicycles. Oh. So it's good to have both in your, if you have that kind of equipment around, and who doesn't have stuff made in places like that?
Well, of course.
It's good to have both kinds of screwdriver, because the Phillips type is actually designed initially, I don't know if I mentioned this, the reasons for its design is if it's over torqued, it'll pop out of the screw instead of tearing it up, which is fine if the screw head matches the screwdriver shape. The JIS screwdrivers, on the other hand, have a X-shaped bit that has sharp corners inside instead of the tapered ones that the Phillips have, so they can actually go in and grab a little harder. Now, if you try to push a Phillips into that kind of a screw, it won't go in all the way, and you'll have a lot of trouble turning it. So that's the story on those.
Okay. Well, I have a simple question.
Oh, good.
You know, we've had a bit of housekeeping there, so we'll just follow it up with a simple question. This one is from Sonia, KN4IZD, and she's asking, what's the best way to overcome mic fright? And I've encountered this myself, really. I mean, it's a common problem.
It certainly is. That's probably one of the reasons that I'm mainly a CW man. As you can tell, I'm very frightened about microphones. But it is a good question, and I think it gets in the way of lots of new hams, keeping them from enjoying or even starting in amateur radio.
Yes.
Because it can be somewhat frightening. Now, there are probably many ways and anecdotes about how to get around this, but I guess I have had two particular thoughts, and I actually got some feedback from Sonia. She found them actually helpful. First, take any opportunities you can to talk to people that you know in person and are comfortable talking to one-on-one in the club meeting or whatever, and talk to them on the radio. That'll make it much easier than if it's someone you haven't met before. And you can either have a set up an arrangement with them to talk to each other, or you could perhaps they all join in a weekly club net on a 2-meter repeater, as there are in our area. If it's the people that you know from your club meetings, it's just like talking to somebody in the club, and it should be easier. That's one way. The other way I think is easy. I find easy. Is to participate in any contest or QSO party. The reason I say that is, unlike having to look at a microphone and say, oh, what am I going to say now for the third time around?
Yes.
When you're in a contest, you have a very well-defined exchange. Usually it's just signal report and some other items such as your state, your ARL section, or perhaps a grid square. And that's all you have to say. And in fact, what I recommend is you get a 3x5 card, and in large letters you write down signal report and whatever.
Yes.
For me, it's FN31 for a grid square.
Grid square.
Yeah, yes. I can't talk in a microphone. Or your state, and I usually can remember what my state is, but just in case, you write down CT, Charlie Tango, or something, and that's it. So the key is to look up the rules of the contest ahead of time, understand what people are likely to need from you in the way of information, and have it ready to say. And you don't have to think about them or think about the microphone. You just say 599, or for voice, 59 Connecticut, or 59 Connecticut Charlie Tango. That's it. I'm sure there are many other techniques too, but those are the two that occurred to me as being very straightforward and easy, and hopefully can help people get over this problem, because I think it'll help make more people comfortable with being on the air.
Excellent. Thank you, Joel.
My pleasure.
If you have a question for the doctor, email us at doctor@arrl.org. The Doctor Is In podcast is sponsored by DX Engineering at www.dxengineering.com. Background music provided by Purple Planet at www.purple-planet.com. This podcast is copyright ARRL. All rights are reserved. Until next time, I'm QST Managing Editor Becky Schoenfeld, W1BXY 73, and thanks for listening.
From Australia, this is VK1WIA and the weekly WIA amateur radio news service on RF, internet streaming and text at wia.org.au.
Yes, it's national news for week commencing October 28, 2018. And bringing you the news this week, the usual group of suspects, Jason, Felix, Bruce, and yours truly, Graham, VK4BB. Now, quite a few of us did time, so to speak, at 1RTB, Kapuka. Kapuka Satellite Ground Station is now under construction. The construction has begun on the Defence Satellite Ground Station at Kapuka, with the first sod being turned by Deputy Prime Minister Michael McCormack on the $24 million project. McCormack said the wideband satellite capability project involved the acquisition and sustainment of a new satellite ground station in the east of Australia in implementation of a wideband SATCOM network management system. I quote, "I'm pleased to be at Kapuka, the home of the soldier, with representatives from the project's contractors for this groundbreaking activity, which will provide flexibility to the Australian Defence Force wideband beyond line-of-sight communications," he said. "This is a wonderful result for the Riverina and Kapuka Army Base to remain a vital cog in Australia's Defence Force network into the future. Once completed in 2021, the ground station will ensure the ADF has an end-to-end communication service consistent with the operational need for network-enabled operations." Keeping on top of interference, Australian Communications and Media Authority. Now, the following was written by Chris Foston, Manager, Communications Infrastructure, ACMA, and was printed in full in Critical Comms. The article cites several cases of interference found in a typical day in the field. a mobile phone carrier had reported to the ACMA that one of its base stations, near Flemington Racecourse, was experiencing interference. An ACMA officer travelled to the area as the information had pointed to a transmitter located in a housing area. The officer scoured the area using a spectrum analyzer, then, using his 800 to 900 megahertz directional Yagi antenna to pinpoint the exact location, they found it on the second floor of a townhouse. With the cooperation of the resident, the inspector quickly identified a malfunctioning indoor TV antenna booster as the source of the interference. The inspector explained to the resident why the device couldn't be used and advised on how TV reception in the townhouse could be improved. With the booster out of action, the carrier's mobile network was restored to its normal performance. While ACMA inspectors are travelling around, they normally do have a spectrum analyzer running in the vehicle, and this will pick up any unusual radio communications activity. In the Melbourne suburb of East Brunswick, the analyzer identified interference in the 1920 to 1930 megahertz frequency range used for mobile phone services here in Australia. The inspector used his directional Yagi antenna and spectrum analyzer to determine the direction of the signal. They soon narrowed it down to a first floor business. After introducing himself and explaining the reason for the visit, the inspector searched for the source of the interference. It came from a wireless VoIP server. The server was part of the business's telecommunications setup and, while other pieces of their phone equipment were appropriately labelled with the relevant compliance mark, this device was not. The device was disconnected, the inspector clearly explaining why the device could not be used in Australia. He also issued a warning notice for the unlicensed operation of a radio communications device. In WIA News, give peace a chance. Later in the bulletin, further on the special call signs issued to the WIA by ACMA to commemorate the arrival of peace at the end of World War I. Look out for Victor India 9 Peace from Christmas Island. Also VI 4 Peace, the 3rd and 4th, then again the 8th to the 10th of November. They're locked in. The Operation 8 to 10 will commence at 000 Zulu on the 8th, concluding 2359 Zulu on the 10th of November on all bands.
Hello, this is VK5 Whiskey Tango Foxtrot with this week's board comment. The WIA has a new affiliated club, and did I ever get distracted trying to find the pronunciation? The town this club shares its name with, from the Sydney Morning Herald article in 1949, claims the town name to be Walkup, but I'm reliably told by Wikipedia it is pronounced Warhope. Either way, the WIA board would like to welcome the Warhope Amateur Radio Club to the WIA. Applications are open for a club or group to hold the 2020 WIA AGM and convention. It's still over 18 months away, and we have a few people in clubs with experience that can help put on an awesome display. If you're not sure if your idea is what the WIA is looking for, send us what you're thinking and we'll definitely consider it. Applications go to secretary@wia.org.au. And something I saw recently. Does your club do challenges or activities to keep your members engaged? Many of the clubs I've been a member of have set small challenges for their members. You could homebrew a simple transmitter or receiver, chase a fox, or even introduce a new mode of operation to your club. What does your club do to keep members engaged and experimenting? Remember to keep the challenge simple enough for newbies to learn, but complex enough for the older crew to be challenged. And remember to share your challenge so other clubs can adapt your ideas for their own members. And apologies for the audio quality, this is being recorded while on holiday. 73, this is VK5 WTF going clear.
News, talk and radio sport, here with VK1 WIA.
Ham Radio Operational News, it's Contact Sport. I'm Felix, VK4FUQ. The CQ Worldwide DXSSB contest is in full modulation right now. She runs from 000 hours UTC Saturday 27th October to 2359 hours UTC Sunday 28th October. The ARRL contest branch has announced that participants in the 2019 ARRL Ready Roundup will be permitted to use the FTA protocol, which is part of the WSJTX software suite. A 1-hour practice contest was held Thursday, October 25 on 7.078 kHz. Through the DX window. Citing security concerns, the 4v7R DX mission to Haiti that was to take place between the 19th and 29th of October has been cancelled. No other details forthcoming. Australia VI. Celebrating this year's World War I Armistice Day centenary, On air November 3 to 15 will be VY6 PAX. South African Radio League News report that in South Africa, the special call ZS100WW1 will be active from 1 to 30 November 2018, in remembrance of the South Africans who were involved in the War to End All Wars. With more war news, it's to Roger Harrison, BK2ZRH, with news about the special event call signs for the centenary of the armistice that ended World War I.
As already advised, the WIA has secured special event call signs for use across all Australian states and territories. These call signs are Victor India Hatch Peace and Victor India Hatch Lima Whiskey Foxtrot VI Hatch LWF, with the hatch representing the call area numerals 1 through 0. In addition, Victor India 100 Peace has also been obtained. The call signs will be available for use over the 9 days between the 3rd and the 11th of November, now coming up fast. In particular, look out for Victor India 9 Peace from Christmas Island. Clubs, groups and or individuals can apply to use the call signs on a roster basis for periods up to 24 hours over the 3rd to 11th November. To make an application, send an email to trainsafe@silvertrain.com.au with armistice call signs in the subject line. That email address can be retrieved from the text version of the broadcast news and on the WIA website. These call signs and their license fees are paid for by the WIA, and the ACMA has agreed on their use for the nominated period. Don't forget that the ACMA license conditions apply when using the special event call signs. Applicants must have an advanced license. Other Allied countries that took part in World War I will also have special event amateur call signs on the air to commemorate the centenary of the armistice signing. Indeed, the Italian special event station, India India 3 Bravo Victor Victor, IO3BVV, began operating last week on 24th October and will continue through to the 4th of November. Look out for IO3BVV on 80, 40 and 20 metres, single sideband, CW and digital modes. The United Kingdom special event station Golf Bravo 100 Alpha Romeo Mike GB100 ARM will be on air over the 1st to the 28th of November. From the United States, look for Whiskey Whiskey 1 Uniform Sierra Alpha WW1 USA, which will be on air over the 3rd and 4th of November. Tango Mike 5 Papa Alpha X-Ray will be operating from France, active on all bands and modes from today, 28th October, through to 11th of November. South Africa will be on air with Zulu Sierra 100 Whiskey Whiskey India for the month of November. Further details, particularly QSL details and website addresses, can be found on the WIA website. This has been Roger Harrison, VK2ZRH, for VK1WIA News.
Thanks, Roger. Over in Europe, YL100 has been created to celebrate Latvia's 100th birthday. On 18 November 2018, Latvia will celebrate its centenary. 5 different call signs will be used between the 1st and the 18th of November with this YL100 prefix, one from each of 4 Latvia's historical regions and the 5th from the capital city Riga. The call signs are YL100K, YL100L, YL100R, YL100V, YL100Z. These call signs will be operated by multiple radio amateurs from the related regions. Special awards for working YL100 stations on different bands and modes will be issued. Short but sweet, this operational news segment this week must be propagation, or lack thereof. In Ingham for VK1WIA National News, I'm Felix, VK4FUQ.
From Australia, this is VK1WIA and the weekly WIA amateur radio news service on RF, internet streaming and text at wia.org.au.
International news with thanks to IARU, RSGB, SARL, Southgate Amateur Radio Club, ARRL, RAC, NZART and the worldwide sources of the WIA. I'm Jason, VK2LAW. Coming soon, the comet of the year. Get ready for a very nice comet. In 2 months, Comet 46P/Wirtanen will sweep past Earth, making one of the 10 closest approaches of a comet to our planet during the space age. If forecasters are correct, Comet Wirtanen will become visible to the naked eye for weeks in December 2018. The small but unusually active comet comes closest to Earth just 4 days after its closest approach to the Sun, and it will be up all night long, making this an exceptional flyby. Visit spaceweather.com for the full story. News from New Zealand, Kilo 1, Whiskey 1. Update on the prohibition of unrestricted two-way radios. In August, we mentioned how in New Zealand their Spectrum Management Agency were creating a prohibition notice for unrestricted two-way radios. This was to limit the availability to the general public for radios that don't meet the radio standards. The prohibition notice came into effect Thursday, 18th of October 2018. The notice will affect the supply of two-way radios like Baofeng, Pofeng, Wuxon to the amateur radio market, but not equipment factory-locked to the amateur bands. From Africa, Radio Ham prevented from leading Chad. ARRL reports a saga that has reached the diplomatic and foreign ministry level is playing out in Africa's Republic of Chad, involving Norwegian radio amateur Kenneth Opskar, Lima Alpha 7, Gulf India Alpha. He had only operated as Tango Tango 8 Kilo Oscar for about 1 day before security police shut down his station October 10. He'd logged 2,150 contacts, already uploaded to Club Log, and all antennas except the 160-meter vertical had been installed. At the time, Opskar was optimistic that he'd soon be back on the air after his license and equipment documentation had been scrutinised by the security police and the foreign ministry, followed by a CW demo. According to information Opskar has been providing on a running basis to DX World, however, he's now being prevented from leaving the country. ARRL.com has the latest and the full story. From the United Kingdom, the RSGB convention video released. The RSGB have released the presentation given by IARU Region 1 President Don Beattie, Golf 3 Bravo Juliet, to the RSGB convention in Milton Keynes, October 13. So what has the IARU ever done for us? What the IARU is and what it does is not well known to radio amateurs. In this talk, Don describes what IARU is doing, how the challenges of representing amateur radio globally are changing, and what the world would be like without IARU. He explains the work done on current threats to amateur spectrum allocations, including wireless power transmission, and describes some of the doomsday scenarios if IARU was not successful. Watch RSGB Convention Lecture 2018. So, what has the IARU ever done for us? The link is in the text edition of this, the WIA National News Service. From the United States of America, complex communications test for NASA Observatory. Critical Comms magazine are reporting that engineers have successfully tested critical communication systems in preparation for the launch of NASA's James Webb Space Telescope. When NASA's James Webb Space Telescope, JWST, launches in 2021, it will write a new chapter in cosmic history. This premier space science observatory will seek the first stars and galaxies, explore distant planets around other stars, and solve mysteries of our own solar system. JWST will be controlled from the Mission Operations Center at the Space Telescope Science Institute in Baltimore, Maryland. To prepare for launch, the flight operations team recently conducted 2 successful communications tests. The first simulated the complex communications amongst numerous entities in the critical period of launch through the first 6 hours of flight. The second demonstrated that the MOC could successfully communicate with the telescope. The link is in the text edition of this week's news at wia.org.au. The Iridium Satellite Network will deliver critical data, imagery and video for the Ocean Cleanup project being conducted by the non-profit organisation deploying advanced technologies to rid the world's oceans of plastic. It will clean up ocean plastic debris, starting with what's known as the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. The Ocean Cleanup has chosen Iridium L-band satellite broadband services to support this important mission by creating a system of 600-meter-long floating plastic collectors, floating screens or systems that include a 3-meter-deep skirt. The Ocean Cleanup project collects plastic pollution through a combination of the wind, waves, natural ocean currents, and the floating screen's ability to prevent plastic escaping underneath it or flowing over the top while avoiding ensnaring sea life. Each system is equipped with two Iridium broadband terminals. When the oceans aren't cooperating and several foot waves and powerful winds are causing havoc, the Iridium system will help make sure the ocean cleanup understands the operational status of each floating screen in the fleet. Again, more information in the links at the text edition of this week's news at wia.org.au. News from Mexico. The Federación Mexicana de Radio Experimentadores, Mexico's IARU member society, is asking radio amateurs to avoid 7.060, 7.130 and 14.120 MHz, where Category 4 Hurricane Willa emergency nets are being operated in Spanish. Willa has been a danger for forecasters as well. An aircraft with the Air Force Reserve's Hurricane Hunters was forced to turn around over concerns for its onboard equipment after a lightning bolt from one of Willa's outer rain bands blasted it, according to the National Hurricane Center in the USA. Commercial airlines started moving out of Willa's path early in the week. Southwest Airlines cancelled all flights at the International Airport in Puerto Vallarta, a resort city in Jalisco State. American Airlines cancelled its flights in Mazatlan, about 275 miles to the north. Again, the frequencies to avoid 7.060, 7.130 and 14.120 MHz. For WIA National News in Sydney, I'm Jason, VK2LAW.
You are listening to VK1WIA and the broadcast of news and information. At 10:30 a.m. and 8 p.m. each Sunday, it is carried by the VK3BWI network through VK3RMM Mount Macedon, VK3RML Mount Dandenong and VK3RMU on Mount St Leonard. Check it out. I'm Barry Robinson, VK3 Papa Victor.
Rewind. And daring spies who broadcast from behind enemy lines. An ITV news report in the UK says owning just one of them in World War II carried the death penalty. But Ian Kaiser, Golf-free Romeo Oscar Oscar, has more than a dozen, ensuring a piece of secret history is brought out into the open. So what are they? They are, of course, spy radios, used to send messages back to base from behind enemy lines, and decades later, much of the collection is still in use. You can watch this ITV news video at the link in this week's text edition of WIA and the National News Service.
From Australia, this is VK1WIA and the weekly WIA amateur radio news service on RF, internet streaming and text at wia.org.au.
Hello, I'm Bruce, VK3FFF from sunny Bendigo. Worldwide Special Interest Groups ATV, Amateur Radio Lunar Satellite LO94 on Hackaday. Now, with apologies to Pink Floyd, signals be waiting for you on the dark side of the moon. Said waiting, waiting for you on the dark side of the moon. Al Williams, WD5GNR, writes on Hackaday about the amateur radio spacecraft LO94, which has been taking pictures from the far side of the moon. The spacecraft was built by students at the Harbin Institute of Technology and launched on May 20th, 2018. LO94 transmits in the 435 to 438 MHz amateur satellite band. Some communications use the WSJT mode, JT4G, but the pictures are sent by slow scan digital video. The SSDV mode was originally developed by UK radio amateurs for use on high altitude balloons. Read the article, Hams See Dark Side of the Moon Without Pink Floyd on Hackaday. ARIS joins NASA on the air for a special SSTV event, October 27 to 29. Amateur radio on the International Space Station is planning a very special slow scan TV event currently scheduled to start this weekend, October 27th, about 10:00 UTC, helping to support the event, NASA's Space Communication and Navigation Department. The SCAN department manages NASA's three most important communications networks, the Space Network, Near-Earth Network, Deep Space Network. Just as in past ARIS SSTV commemorations, 12 images will be downlinked, but this time with 6 featuring the SCAN educational activities, while the other 6 images will commemorate major NASA anniversaries, i.e. when NASA was established, astronauts first landing on the moon, etc. In addition to the fun of receiving these images, participants can qualify for a special endorsement for the NASA On the Air Celebration event. The transmissions are expected to be broadcast at the usual frequency of 145.800 MHz using the PD120 SSTV mode. Worldwide Special Interest Groups Defence. Ham radio spacecraft signal decoded after bouncing off moon. Radio amateur Daniel Estevez, EA4GPZ, MOHXM, reports decoding a JT4G signal from the LO94 spacecraft that was reflected off the moon. Daniel says JT4G is a digital mode designed for Earth-Moon-Earth microwave communications, so it is tolerant to high Doppler spreads. However, the reflections of the transmitter at 435.4 MHz, which contained the JT4G transmissions, were very weak. So, he said, I had not attempted to decode the JT4G moon bounce signal. However, by analysing a recording made on October 19, he was able to decode one of the 5 JT4G transmissions in the recording. The DSL-WP amateur radio satellites, built by students from the Harvard Institute of Technology, was launched to lunar orbit on May 20, 2018. Worldwide Special Interest Groups, Females in Radio, ALARA and WIA Luncheon. Sunday, 14th of October, the president of ALARA, Shirley, VK5YL, and the president of WIA, Justin, VK7TW, met and enjoyed lunch together along with many other ALARA members and partners. Shirley was in Tasmania for one of her other hobbies, lace making, and Linda, VK7QP, VK7 ALARA coordinator, organised a lunch gathering at the Christmas Hill Raspberry Farm. Worldwide Special Interest Groups, Final Frontier. A day of satellite operating from a deck on the RMS Queen Mary docked at Long Beach in Southern California is slated for December 15th. Operations will be portable, almost like a field day, and should include FM, SSB, and possibly packet. Depending on staffing, there may also be HF activity during the satellite operation. All operations from the Queen Mary will be as W6RO, the call sign for the wireless room on the ship operated by the Associated Radio Amateurs of Long Beach. Worldwide Special Interest Groups IOTA, www.iota-world.org. Islands on the Air has announced the first of 6 new IOTA groups. The new groups cover a Swedish Finnish joint sovereignty island and groups in North America, Asia and Oceania. All new groups have provisional numbers. This means they will need to be confirmed by a 1,000-plus QSO operation that takes place after the 14th of October 2018, as well as meeting the other normal validation requirements. Only after confirmation of the number will credit for past operations be considered. The provisional new groups are Catcher Island, EU-192P, Moraine Atoll in the Tuamotu Islands, OC-297P, Puerto Rico Coastal Islands, NA-249P, Yakutat County Group, NA-250P, Bering Sea Coast East Group, AS-205P, and Kuril Sky Islands North, AS-204. Apologies for pronunciation. Worldwide Special Interest Groups Rescue Radio. Cyclone Sunday promotes community awareness of the cyclone season in VK's Northeast. Organised by the Townsville City Council at Strand Park and supported by the Townsville Amateur Radio Club, it blows into town Sunday, 4th of November, between 3 and 6 p.m. Are you cyclone ready? Whether you are a new resident to Townsville or have lived there for years, Cyclone Sunday is a must-attend community event. Special interest groups, worldwide flora and fauna parks program. Summerland Amateur Radio Club suggest go for a talk in the park. Into amateur radio? International parks. Why not combine both and activate a national park or nature reserve? VKFF is the Australian chapter of WWFF, the Worldwide Flora and Fauna in Amateur Radio Organisation. Their aim is to promote portable amateur radio operation from designated national parks and protected natural areas around the world. Another 14 new WWFF parks in and around Lismore have recently been added to the list. For example, Victoria Park on the Alstonville Plateau is one of the parks. You can drive there on sealed roads, and it wouldn't be that hard to rack up the minimum of 10 simplex contacts on 2 metres to qualify as an activation. Just imagine what you could do with a bit of HF gear. This has been Bruce, VK3FFF.
This is VK1WIA. All points of contacts from today's news stories are to be found in print when you read the web editions, www.wia.org.au.
Socially speaking, in November 3 in VK3, it's Melbourne's QRP by the Bay and also QRP by the Harbour in VK2. The Amateur Radio New South Wales Radio Homebrew and Experimenters Group will be holding a QRP gathering Saturday the 3rd of November at McIlwain Park in Rhodes, the location by the water on the site of the old Phillips radio factory. Now, start time is 3 p.m, which coincides with the QRP by the Bay in VK3. And if it's raining, the group will retire to the Kokoda Cafe in Rhodes Park, just about 300 metres south. Look for QRP by the Harbour on Facebook. November 11 in VK5, it's Adelaide Hills Amateur Radio Society's Hamfest. November 17 in VK7, the VK7 Hamfest, Miana Community Centre. And in VK3, November 18, the Rosebud Radio Fest. Now, until next we meet, I'm Graham, VK4BB. Thanks for listening and walk softly.
From Australia, this has been VK1WIA and the weekly WIA Amateur Radio News Service. On RF, we thank our rebroadcast team and you for listening. And remember, internet streaming and text of this news is available 24/7 at wia.org.au.
Hallo, liebe SWLs, YLs und OM. Sie hören den Deutschlandrundspruch Nummer 43 des Deutschen Amateurradioclubs für die 43. Kalenderwoche 2018. Erstsendetermin 25. Oktober. Diesmal haben wir Meldungen zu folgenden Themen. Erfolgreiche ISS-Kontakte mit Osterholz-Scharmbeck, Soltau, Dessau und Dresden. Gisela Domen, Delta Lima 9, Delta Juliet, ist neue Distriktsvorsitzende Köln-Aachen, Distrikt Golf. Notfunk im Fokus, 25 Aktive trafen sich in Baunatal. Dann gibt es eine neue Videoreihe, Interview unter dem Turm. Tag der Begegnung, natürlich mit Amateurfunk. Dann haben wir einen Bericht vom 24. Amateurfunktreffen in Gössel am Grundlsee im Programm. Dann gibt es aktuelle Conteste und was gibt es Neues vom Funkwetter. Zum ersten Thema im Deutschlandrundspruch, erfolgreiche ISS-Kontakte mit Osterholz-Scharmbeck, Soltau, Dessau und Dresden. Am Dienstag, den 23. Oktober, hatten die Schülerinnen und Schüler der integrierten Gesamtschule Osterholz-Scharmbeck und des Gymnasiums Soltau die Möglichkeit, ESA-Astronaut Alexander Gerst, KF5ONO, ihre vorbereiteten Fragen zu stellen. Um 11.14 Uhr zeigte sich, dass sich die Mühe und die Aufregung rund um den geplanten Funkkontakt mit der Internationalen Raumstation gelohnt hatten. Wie Jan-Hendrik Preine, Delta Kilo 1 Oscar Mike, berichtet, hatte Soltau von der ersten bis zur letzten Minute perfekten, fast rauchfreien Empfang von der ISS. Die Funkamateure vor Ort konnten den Kontakt mit Alexander Gerst sogar noch bei minus 2 Grad Elevation, also knapp unter dem Horizont, aufrechterhalten, bevor das Signal im Rauschen unterging. Die Telefonbrücke zwischen Osterholz, Schambeck und Soltau sorgte dafür, dass man auch die Fragen der jeweils anderen Schule auf die Saallautsprecher geben konnte. Das Team des Ortsverbandes Walsrode, Hotel 02, arbeitete in Soltau toll zusammen und brachte einen erfolgreichen Kontakt vor großem Auditorium zustande. In Osterholz war es nicht anders. Am gestrigen Mittwoch, den 24. Oktober, gab es einen weiteren ARISS-Schulkontakt des Liborius-Gymnasiums Dessau und des Martin-Andersen-Nexö-Gymnasiums Dresden sowie der DLR School Lab der Technischen Universität Dresden. Gegen 10.22 Uhr Ortszeit konnten die Schülerinnen und Schüler direkten Funkkontakt mit Alexander Gerst aufnehmen. Etwa 11 Minuten hatten die Schüler der beiden Schulen Zeit, dem Funkamateur und Astronauten Gerst ihre Fragen zu stellen. Auch hier klappte alles einwandfrei. Mit vor Ort waren auch die TV-Teams von Faszination Amateurfunk, der Fernsehsendung rund um das Thema Amateurfunk, sowie von Interview unter dem Turm, der neuen Videoreihe des DARC e.V. Weitere Informationen zum Thema ISS-Schulkontakte sind auf der Webseite der ARISS zu finden. Gisela Domen, Delta Lima 9, Delta Juliet, ist neue Distriktsvorsitzende von Köln-Aachen, Distrikt Golf. Auf der Distriktsversammlung in Troisdorf wurde Gisela Domen, DL9DJ, zur neuen Vorsitzenden von Köln-Aachen, Distrikt Golf gewählt. Ihre Stellvertretung übernehmen Stefan Scharfenstein, Delta Juliet 5 Kilo X-Ray und Dr. Kai Hübener, Delta Lima 3, Hotel Alpha Hotel. Über 80 Mitglieder aus 39 Ortsverbänden nahmen an dieser Versammlung teil, die vom ansässigen Ortsverband Golf 27 organisiert wurde. Die Neuwahl war aufgrund des Rücktrittes zweier Vorstandsmitglieder erforderlich gewesen. Weitere Informationen zum Distrikt Köln-Aachen finden Sie auch im Internet unter www.darc.de/g wie Golf. Notfunk im Fokus. 25 Aktive trafen sich in Baunatal. Das Thema Not- und Katastrophenfunk im DARC ist ein Thema in vielen Ortsverbänden und Distrikten bundesweit. Notfunkreferent Oliver Schlag, Delta Lima 7 Tango November Yankee, hat die Aktiven aus dem gesamten Bundesgebiet eingeladen, um die Konzeption des Referates abzustimmen. Er konnte bereits am Freitag 25 Teilnehmer aus den Distrikten Alpha, Bravo, Delta, Echo, Golf, Hotel, Kilo, November, Oscar, Papa, Quebec, Romeo, Sierra, Tango, Uniform, Victor, Whiskey und Yankee begrüßen. Wir unterhalten uns über Grundsatzfragen des Notfunks wie Versicherung, Ausrichtung und Zusammenarbeit mit Bedarfsträgern. Zudem geht es um interessante technische Entwicklungen im Bereich des Notfunks, wie zum Beispiel AREDN, führt Notfunkreferent Delta Lima 7 Tango November Yankee durch die Tagesordnung. Neue Videoreihe Interview unter dem Turm. In der neuen Videoreihe Interview unter dem Turm stellt der DARC e.V. Funkamateure und ihre Leidenschaft für ihr Projekt bzw. den Amateurfunk vor. In der ersten Folge sprachen wir mit Silvio Kunze, Delta Mike 9 Kilo Sierra. Er betreibt das Internetblog hamspirit.de und gibt außerdem die gleichnamige Zeitschrift heraus, welche die Medienlandschaft im Bereich des Amateurfunks ergänzen will. Im Interview stellt er außerdem klar, dass er eine nachwachsende Generation junger Funkamateure in der heutigen Zeit sieht. Den kurzweiligen Videobeitrag finden Sie ebenso auch wie weitere Videos aus dem DARC e.V. auf dem DARC YouTube-Kanal. Wir freuen uns jederzeit über neue Abonnenten. Tag der Begegnung natürlich mit Amateurfunk. Im Rahmen der Woche des Sehens, welche jedes Jahr im Oktober stattfindet, veranstaltete das Aura Hotel Saulgrub einen Tag der Begegnung. Dieser hatte das Ziel, blinde, sehbehinderte und sehende Menschen aller Altersgruppen zusammenzubringen und auf diese Weise das gegenseitige Verstehen zu fördern. Bei herrlichem Wetter gab es ein vielseitiges, buntes Programm sowie viele Aktionen zum aktiven Mitmachen. Auch die Clubstation Delta Foxtrot 0 Bravo Hotel, welche seit vielen Jahren in Saulgrub eingerichtet und 2015 mit modernster Technik auf den neuesten Stand gebracht wurde, hatte viele Interessenten angezogen. So konnten sich die Besucher über alle Facetten des Amateurfunks, sowohl digital als auch analog, informieren. Da hier auch Funkamateure mit Ausbildungsrufzeichen anwesend waren, bestand die Möglichkeit für Interessenten im Selbstversuch praktische Erfahrungen zu sammeln. Ein besonderes Highlight war ein QSO via Kurzwelle in die USA. Stefan Unterstraßer, Delta Kilo 1 Mike Sierra Uniform, schreibt dazu: Mein Dank gilt Direktorin Kerstin Skudrin und dem Team des Aura Hotels, da uns hier die Möglichkeit gegeben wird, eine Amateurfunkstation zu betreiben, sowie den Mitgliedern von Charlie 03, welche uns immer mit Rat und Tat zur Seite stehen. Das Aura Hotel Saulgrub ist ein perfekt auf die Belange blinder und sehbehinderter Menschen abgestimmtes Hotel im Landkreis Garmisch-Partenkirchen. Neben der Möglichkeit, hier seinen Urlaub zu verbringen, dient es auch als Veranstaltungsort vieler Seminare und Schulungen. Bericht vom 24. Amateurfunktreffen in Gössel am Grundlsee. 40 Funkamateure mit ihren Angehörigen und Freunden aus DL, namentlich aus Draxelsried, Nürnberg, Passau, Siegsdorf sowie Unterneukirchen, sowie aus Oskar Echo 1, 2, 5 und 6 nahmen bei traumhaftem Herbstwetter am Wochenende vom 13. bis 14. Oktober an dem Traditionstreffen teil. Einige Freunde waren zum ersten Mal dabei. Am Samstagvormittag stand ab 9.30 Uhr eine Fahrt im Konvoi vom Veranstaltungsort auf dem Ausseerhausberg, dem Loser, auf dem Programm. Oben angekommen unternahm man einen Spaziergang zum kleinen Augstsee. Viele QSOs mit SOTA-Stationen wurden von dort oben getätigt. Nach einem gemeinsamen Mittagessen stand der Nachmittag zur freien Verfügung. Während einige Teilnehmer Wanderungen und Kurzausflüge unternahmen, führte OM Hans, Delta Delta 7 Mike Hotel aus Unterneukirchen, interessierte Teilnehmer in die Welt der Gigahertz-Technik ein und zeigte einige seiner selbstgefertigten Bandpassfilter bzw. Antennen für diesen Frequenzbereich. Da ihr Clublokal an diesem Abend geschlossen hatte, verlegten die Funkamateure der Ortsgruppe Lietzen, angeführt durch ihren Obmann Viktor, Oskar Echo 6, Viktor Mike Echo, kurzerhand ihren Clubabend nach Gössel. Am Sonntagvormittag hieß es dann wieder Abschied nehmen vom steirischen Salzkammergut, nicht ohne dem Versprechen, sich auch im nächsten Jahr wieder zu treffen, dann vom 11. bis 13. Oktober und dann bereits zum 25. Mal. Darüber berichtet Ingo König, Oskar Echo 2, India Kilo November. Aktuelle Conteste an diesem Wochenende, da dominiert natürlich vom 27. bis 28. Oktober alles den CQ Worldwide DX Contest in SSB. Die Ausschreibung dazu finden Sie auf der Webseite des Contest-Referats sowie mittels der Contest-Termintabelle in der CQDL in der Oktoberausgabe 10/2018 auf Seite 56. Der Funkwetterbericht vom 21. Oktober, herausgegeben wie immer von Hartmut Büttig, DL1 VDL. Ob der Worked All Germany Contest im Kalender der Sonne vermerkt war? Der solare Flux betrug 70 Fluxeinheiten und das geomagnetische Feld war vom 17. Oktober mittags bis zum 21. Oktober mittags absolut ruhig mit K gleich 0. Der Sonnenwind wehte mit einer Geschwindigkeit zwischen 270 und 370 Kilometern pro Sekunde. Die für den vergangenen Freitag vorhergesagte Störung fiel schlichtweg aus. Bereits vor dem Wochenende hörte man auf den unteren Bändern alle Deexpeditionen laut. Mittags war der östliche Funkweg zu VK9 X-Ray auf 24 MHz brauchbar. Am Samstagnachmittag war das 15 Meter Band nach ganz Amerika offen. 20 Meter bescherte laute Signale aus allen Erdteilen. Die ersten Nordamerikaner riefen auf 40 Meter nach 21 Uhr UTC an und auf 80 Meter 90 Minuten später. Am Sonntagmittag hörte man auf 40 Meter bereits Stationen aus Fernost. Nur das 10 Meter Band öffnete nicht bei der sehr geringen Sonnenaktivität. Am Sonntag gab es kurze Short-Skip-Bedingungen durch Sporadik E. Vorhersage bis zum 30. Oktober, die Sonnentätigkeit bleibt sehr gering. Die solaren Fluxwerte bleiben knapp unter 70 Fluxeinheiten. Nach der kurzen, aber kaum zu bemerkenden geomagnetischen Störung am Mittag des 21. Oktober sind bis Wochenmitte nahezu ungestörte Ausbreitungsbedingungen angesagt. Die weitere Entwicklung hängt von der Entwicklung koronaler Löcher ab. Wir erwarten gute Ausbreitungsbedingungen auf allen Bändern zwischen 160 und 20 Meter. Manchmal öffnen auch 17 und 15 Meter morgens nach Japan und abends nach Amerika. Und hier noch die Orientierungszeiten für Greyline DX alle Zeiten in UTC. Sonnenaufgang in Neuseeland ist um 17.27 Uhr, in Ostaustralien um 19.25 Uhr, In Westaustralien um 21.28 Uhr. In Singapur geht die Sonne auf um 22.46 Uhr Weltzeit. In Japan um 20.53 Uhr. Auf Hawaii um 16.30 Uhr. Sonnenaufgang in Anchorage in Alaska ist um 16.59 Uhr Weltzeit. In Johannesburg in Südafrika um 3.25 Uhr. An der USA-Westküste in Kalifornien um 14.26 Uhr. Auf den Falklandinseln um 8.36 Uhr. Und in Berlin in Deutschland geht die Sonne um 5.45 Uhr Weltzeit auf. Sonnenuntergang USA-Ostküste 22.04 Uhr. USA-Westküste 1.22 Uhr. In Sao Paulo in Brasilien, dort geht die Sonne unter um 21.14 Uhr UTC, auf den Falklandinseln um 22.47 Uhr, auf Hawaii um genau 4 Uhr, in Anchorage in Alaska geht die Sonne unter um 2.20 Uhr Weltzeit, in Johannesburg in Südafrika um 16.18 Uhr, in Neuseeland um 6.44 Uhr und in Berlin in Deutschland verschwindet die Sonne um 15.55 Uhr UTC hinter dem Horizont. Das war der DARC Deutschland-Rundspruch für diese Woche. Die Redaktion hatte diesmal mein Kollege Thorsten Schmidt, Delta Oscar 1, Delta Alpha Alpha, vom Amateurfunkmagazin CQDL. Am Mikrofon war für Sie Michael Eggers, Delta Lima 9, Lima Bravo Golf. Meldungen für den Deutschland-Rundspruch, also mit bundesweiter Relevanz, schicken Sie bitte per Post oder Fax an die Redaktion CQDL. Sie kennen ja die bekannte Adresse Lindenallee 4 in Baunatal, sowie per E-Mail bitte ausschließlich an die Adresse redaktion@darc.de. Den Deutschlandrundspruch gibt es auch als PDF und MP3-Datei auf der DARC-Webseite, in Packet Radio unter der Rubrik DARC sowie auch als E-Mail-Abonnement. Über die DARC-Webseite können Sie sich dazu jederzeit an- und abmelden. Bitte bewahren Sie dazu Ihre Mitgliedsnummer und Ihr Passwort stets griffbereit auf. Vielen Dank fürs Zuhören und AWDH bis zur nächsten Woche.
Und an alle Macias, 88.
PA00 News følgende udsendelse indeholder nogle chokerende eksempler på, hvordan en hobby kan ændre liv i unge under 18. Kraftigt tilstedeværelsen af en voksen anbefales.
7, 8, 4, 0, 5, 1, 2, 7, 4, 9, 7. Achtung alle Mitarbeiter der Nachrichtendienste, bitte beachten Sie freitagabends die Sendungen PA00 News für die wichtigsten weitere Informationen.
Dit is Papa Alpha 0 Echo Tango Echo.